Are you and God tight? Do you ever wonder, when something doesn't go your way, if God is sending you a message? If God could be mad at you? If God might be trying to get your attention? If you have done something wrong to upset God? Do you ever think like that? You know what? I do. Sometimes. Sometimes I do that. Sometimes I think that way. I don't think it's good to think that way. I don't think that's consistent with what I teach and with what I believe, but sometimes I can't help myself. Here's an example. When I was parenting my sons while they were younger, and whenever one of them would get into trouble, okay, it didn't happen a lot. Happened once. Well, more than once. But whenever one of them got into trouble, I would think to myself, God is punishing me for something I did or for something I did not do. I would think, God is punishing me for not spending enough time with my children. He wasn't. He was observing the whole thing. I eventually understood that I needed to spend more time in their lives, that I needed to provide more guidance, and I needed to be more available to them than I had been, and so I would do just that. God helped me to learn from the situation, I believe, but God was not punishing me by having them, by having one of them get into trouble. Do you ever play games like that with yourself? Are you secure in your faith? This is the third week in which we have been discussing faith. If you were here for week number one, we talked about developing faith in our children and in ourselves. That was the week that we had the close of Vacation Bible School. We also had baptism, and so we talked about baptism, and we talked about the vows that are taken at baptism by the families and the churches, and we talked about how when we do Vacation Bible School, that's one example of the church carrying out the vows of baptism. Last week, we spoke of embracing our faith the way people like Abel and Noah and Abraham and Sarah and Hannah and Esther did. We realized that people of great faith have an awareness of God. They have knowledge of God's presence in their lives, and they have a memory of how God has worked in the lives of other people of great faith. We spoke of how people of great faith realize that in order to experience what God has in store for them, even in the midst of difficulties, that they must stick with God, that they must rely upon God, and that they must trust God. So let's go back to the opening question, are you secure in your faith? Is the answer yes or no, or sometimes yes and sometimes no? And if the answer is sometimes yes and sometimes no, does that answer depend on whether you have been good or bad? Whether you think you may have made God angry with you or not? You see, that kind of thinking, the thinking that says how God feels about us depends on our behavior, that kind of thinking interferes in our ability to live the life of faith that God intends for us. Now, stay with me here, because I'm about to explain some fundamentally important stuff that ties together to create an accurate and beautiful faith situation for all of us. A couple of points to make, four of them. First of all, not one of us is perfect. We all sin. Well, now, wait a minute. I could be wrong. So we'll just take a minute now. If you are perfect, would you please stand? Okay, that's what I thought. Let the record show that I'm standing not because I'm perfect, but because I'm sharing the message today. None of us is perfect. If you need a scripture verse here, try this one. For all have sinned and fall short of God's glory. That's Romans 3:23. The second point. Sin leads to separation from God, and it leads to death. For the wages of sin is death. That's Romans 6:23. God, in his love for you and me, sent his only Son to provide forgiveness for our sin. Jesus was perfect, and so his death paid the penalty for our sin. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. That's John 3:16. Jesus himself said, I have come that you may have life. That's John 10:10. And he said, and Jesus said, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. That's John 3:17. Point number three, God sent his Son Jesus to save us from sin. Sin can be gone from our lives through Jesus Christ if we want. The impact of sin can be gone from our lives. It is as if our life is a whiteboard that is congested with sin, and Jesus is the eraser. Our sins prevent us from getting to God, from being in the presence of God, and from experiencing life in all its fullness. Life is God, who created us, intends for us to have. So, no one is perfect. Sin leads to separation from God and death. God sent his Son to save us from sin. And then four, God makes the effort. Jesus does the work, and all we need to do is accept it, receive it, and believe. Accept, receive, believe. Remember when the person was asked, what shall I do to be saved? And the answer was, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe. Believe what? Now, this is important. Believe that Jesus is God's Son. Believe that Jesus lived a sinless life. Believe that Jesus died for our sins and rose from the dead. Believe that Jesus is sufficient, that his death and resurrection are all that's needed to save us from sin. Believe that it's up to Jesus to save us and not up to us. Believe that no matter what we do from this point forward, God won't stop loving us. No matter what we do from this point forward, and God will always be willing to forgive our sin. You got that now? It's not that complicated. But for some reason, we try to make it more complex. For some reason, we try to make it about our behavior. But friends, it's not about what we do. It is about what God has done. And so, in a way, I've just explained the first part of our reading from Ephesians. If you can remember as much as you can of what I've just said to you, listen to now these words from Paul, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. Side comment, remember the wages of sin is death. In which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, remember, for God so loved the world, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. You see, it's not about what we do. It's about what God has done. So why do we do that? Why do we try to make it more complicated than it needs to be? Why do we insist upon making it about us, about our behavior, about what we do? Maybe we do that because we are so bright, so smart, so successful. Maybe we were taught somewhere along the way that if something good is going to happen in our lives, then it's up to us to do it, to get it done. Perhaps we were taught not to rely upon anyone else for anything else. Did a wise person once say to us, "There is no such thing as luck, you make your own luck"? Or it could be that we honestly think we have no sin in our lives, that we never do anything wrong, and therefore we have nothing for which we need forgiveness. That's wrong. And if you feel that way, maybe you just need someone to follow you around to show you where you fall short. That's a message for another day. But remember Romans 3:23, all have sinned. Or perhaps we are unwilling to or unable to accept something for nothing. Have you thought about that? Because a lot of people are like that. Have you ever given someone a gift at Christmas and they say to you, "But I don't have a present for you"? Or they will say something like, well, we don't exchange gifts at Christmas." I love those moments. I love to do that. Sometimes I think I give like that just to be devilish, just to make people feel uncomfortable. But if you've ever been on the receiving end of one of those gifts and you don't reciprocate, it creates an uncomfortable moment. But you know what that moment really is? That moment really is a grace-filled moment. That's grace. Somebody giving you something and not reciprocating. Most people have difficulty receiving something for nothing. That's the basis of an entire approach to solicitation, isn't it? The American Veterans Association will send you free address stickers again and again and again and again, hoping that you will feel obligated to make a donation. The National Arbor Foundation offers you free trees, hoping that you will not be able to accept their gift without giving something back in return. So if you embrace that reasoning that you can't take something for nothing, then you are probably preventing your intentional faith development from moving in a positive direction. Not only that, you are likely to be unwilling to accept God's grace, his free, unearned love, and the salvation that comes along with it. During the summers, while I was in college, I worked with three guys who had moved up north from Swansea, South Carolina. And they'd moved up north to build houses with a friend of theirs who had a framing business. They were all much older than I was. I was still in college, as I said. One of them was a high school graduate. One of them had quit high school. And one of those guys had never learned to read or write. Someone had taught him to sign his signature so that he could sign checks, but that was later on in his life. At an early time in his life, he was one of those people who simply made his mark to cash a check. He could read a tape measure. Sure, he could read the numbers on a tape measure, but when he would read it, he would often say 35 and two little lines and a big line. It was that guy, that third guy, who taught me a lesson about grace that I really didn't recognize I had learned until yesterday. He and I had worked side by side quite often. On one particular day, he and I spent the entire day together laying hardwood floors. And as the day had come to a close and we were putting the tools away in his truck, a guy he had known for some time drove up in his pickup truck, and he got out of his truck and he walked over to this guy and he handed him a bag of tomatoes. And on the way home, I asked him why the man gave him those tomatoes. I thought maybe they were sort of backyard farmers, and when they had too much of something, this guy would give it to him, and when he had something, he would give it back to the guy. So I said to him, I said, why'd he give you those tomatoes, Dick? And Dick said, Dave, that man just likes me. That's all there is to it. He just likes me. Well, you know, when it comes to us and God and our salvation, it is something that we do not earn. It is a gift. It is a gift that is given to us because God just likes us. That's all there is to it. God just likes us. Now, moving to verse 8, Paul writes, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. Remember, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this, the grace part, the savedness, is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works. We are not saved by the things that we do, not by our works, so that no one could boast." See, it's not about what we do. It's about what God has done. You know, it had to be probably my first, maybe my second Christmas Eve service at Ingomar Church. And I was sitting up here on the steps, and I was sharing a message with the children, and we were opening gifts as a way to retell the Christmas story. And finally, all of the gifts were open, and each gift had been explained in terms of their part of that entire story. And I concluded my time with them by summing up the Christmas story for them. I guess I was kind of hoping that their eyes would sparkle and that there would be one of those aha moments where each child would give me a look like finally they understood and finally they got it, and that it made sense finally to them in some profound way that it never had before. But this time, I did not receive that kind of a response, but I received a different one. Some of you may have been there and you remember this. Jason Hunkley was seated on the steps with me over there by the music stands, and he was paying close attention, hanging on every word. And so I said, "And that's the story of Christmas." And without missing a beat, Jason said, "Well, we all knew that." And I watched as his parents kind of slid down in the pews. But you see, the story of Christmas was nothing new to him. And as I think about the thrust of this message today, I feel as though the scripture is very familiar and its interpretation has been shared here often. I feel like maybe some of you want to say, "Well, we knew all that. Saved by grace through faith, not by works. We knew that." But you see, knowing it and living it are two separate actions. Knowing it and living it put us all in the same place, where no one is better than anyone else, and we all stand together in need of God's grace. We are all unable to earn our salvation. We can only receive it. We all need to humbly accept this fact for ourselves. God just likes us, and that's all there is to it. He just likes us.